Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Anne-Marie Turpak, and I'm the Development Director here at Catholic Theological Union. And I'd like to thank you for joining us on such an exquisite Sunday afternoon to hear Father Steve Bevan speak on reaching for fidelity, what it means to be Catholic today. Father Steve is currently the Louis Luzbatek Professor of Mission and Culture at CTU. He's a Roman Catholic priest in the Society of the Divine Word, an international missionary congregation, and served for 9 years as a missionary in the Philippines. His publications include Models of Contextual Theology, Constance in Context, A Theology of Mission for Today, with Father Roger Schrader, who is in the audience and one of our faculty members as well, Evangelization and Freedom with Jeffrey Gross, and Introduction to Theology in Global Perspective. Father Steve is past president of the American Society of Missiology and past member of the Board of Directors of the Catholic Theological Society of America. In 2009, he was visiting lecturer at Yarra Theological Union in Melbourne, Australia. And in the fall of 2009, he served as scholar in residence at the Crowther Center of Mission Studies at the headquarters of the Church Missionary Society in Oxford. He also serves as the faculty moderator for Catholics on Call here at CTU. Welcome, Steve.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Annie. I really appreciate your introduction, and I'm kind of overwhelmed by the number of people who have come to celebrate Sunday at CTU today, both our talk and then our Mass afterwards. And it's really wonderful to be here and to see you all. And there's so many people that I know and am close to, whether from CTU or the St. Giles Family Mass community or old students from the 25 years that I've been here at CTU. So it's really wonderful to see you all. And those of you I don't know, I hope to meet you at some point afterwards when we have our reception after the Eucharist. Just for your general information, this talk is being video recorded, and it's excuse me, and it's going to be posted on our new, I guess you call it, website on the CTU website called Learn at CTU. So if you want to revisit it, or if it's any good and you want to share it with anybody, you certainly are welcome to do that. So this afternoon's presentation, this afternoon's presentation is, I haven't used this thing before, so it's a little tricky. Is going to be in two parts. My first part is going to be called the vision of Catholicism, kind of laying out what I think Catholicism is all about. And then secondly, in the second part, I'm going to be talking about tensions that I see in the vision. And what I'm going to say is that it is fidelity to the vision and the living out of the tensions that are endemic to the vision that is the challenge for us to be Catholics today, and how we live out our Christianity, our Catholic Christianity, in our world and in our church today. So let's begin with the first part, which is the vision of Catholicism. What Catholicism, kind of in general, is all about. I want to start with maybe a disturbing quotation from a man who many people consider the greatest theologian of the 20th century. Some people would say the greatest theologian would be Karl Rahner. Others would say it would be Karl Barth, who's not a Catholic. And you'll see why in a minute. In his 1932 preface to his great work, and in some ways the greatest work of theology in the 20th century, The Church Dogmatics, Bart writes this: "I regard the analogia entis, the analogy of being, and I'll explain that as we go along. I regard the analogia entis as the intention of Antichrist. And I think that because of it, one cannot become a Catholic. Whereupon, I at the same time allow myself to regard all other possible reasons for not becoming a Catholic as short-sighted and lacking in seriousness." And Bart was right. He mitigated this very strong position in his later years, but his intuition was really right. Because the central principle on which Catholicism rests is this principle of the analogy of being, or that there exists a continuity between our being and God's being. That's a radical statement. But that is the fundamental principle, really, of the Catholic vision. The picture over there is the bridge over what's called Lake Lefaire at St. Mary of the Woods College in Terre Haute, Indiana. I'm on the board of trustees, and the president just sent us that picture, and that's the image I want to use, that there is somehow a bridge innate, created between ourselves and God. That in our very DNA, in our very structure as human beings, there is a link between ourselves and God. So human experience, human knowledge, human language is capable of reaching God. This is what the First Vatican Council taught in 1870, that somehow or another, through our human experience, through our human knowledge, we have an entree into the reality of God. Not that we can capture God, by no means. No, not that we can understand everything about God, but that there is something inside of us that enables us, if we're honest and open, to have access to the reality of God. Some glimmer, perhaps, but to have real access to the reality of God. And so, the world, human persons, human experiences, these are all pluses for Catholics, not minuses. I was editing an essay by the great anthropologist Mary Douglas the other week. She has an essay in a book that I'm editing, and she quotes Cardinal Newman, blessed John Henry Cardinal Newman now, to talk about the doctrine of matter. He talks about the doctrine of matter, that matter is good, that human experience is good, that human persons are basically good. There's nothing that is bad of itself, you know, of matter. It can be used badly, it can be used wrongly, but there's nothing that is really bad. And that's why, when you think about it, there's no laws against drinking alcohol. There's no law against even tobacco. Maybe there should be, but there's no law about tobacco. there's no law about the kind of food we eat. You know, and that's the doctrine of matter, or the doctrine of the material that Bart talks about. And so the world and human persons and human experiences within the Catholic vision are, or can be anyway, anything can be a vehicle for God's revelation. Now, it's not that, as I said before, the material or human beings and so forth cannot be evil, but they're evil because they're so good. When things go awry or when people make wrong decisions, you know, they ruin the goodness that they are. They misuse the goodness of things. I remember reading a couple of months ago about the medieval mystic Julian of Norwich. And she wrote saying, you know, when we sin, God is not angry. God is sad because we've perverted who we are. We've perverted the good that we are. I think that's very, very basic to this whole Catholic vision that we're talking about. During the Reformation, people like Luther and Calvin talked about the absolute corruption of the human person. And the Council of Trent, in answer to that, says, no, human persons are not corrupt, they're wounded. So there's still that goodness, even in evil, even in sin. There's still that spark of lovableness in everyone, you know, despite their evil and despite their sin. So for Catholics, the papacy, magisterium, reason, devotion to Mary, all these kind of basic things that we think about as, you know, part of the standard parts of Catholicism, these are all important, but ultimately they're derivative from this basic principle of the analogy of being. What it says, and here's the fancy Latin term, finitum capax infiniti, that the finite is somehow capable of the infinite. It's a radical statement, but it is part of what it means to be Catholic. That's why Catholics work in what the theologian David Tracy, who taught many years at the University of Chicago, says Catholics work with an analogical imagination. And Andrew Greeley picks that idea up and popularizes it a little bit and says that's why we have a Catholic imagination. Catholics imagine the world in a different way than other Christians or other people of faith imagine the world. They imagine the world as this good, holy reality that is capable of coming to God, that is capable of revealing the reality of God. Now, perhaps a less philosophical, a less abstract way of talking about this is to talk about sacramentality. Sacramentality, which is the one of the other basic principles of Catholicism. Richard McBrien, in his large book on Catholicism, writes this about sacramentality. He says, sacramentality means that the visible, the tangible, the finite, the historical, all these are actual or potential carriers of the divine presence. Indeed, it is only in and through these material realities that we can even encounter the invisible God. So Catholicism says we need the material in order to know God. There's no other way that we can know God except through our experience, through our world, through history, and so forth. And it's because of sacramentality that the secular can reveal the sacred, or that the imminent, what is close, can reveal, wow, you know, the transcendent nature of God, or the particular and the partial. You know, William Blake wasn't a Catholic, but Anglo-Catholic for sure, to see the universe in a grain of sand. You know, the particular can reveal the whole. That a person or an object, you know, is not identified with the divine. Statues of Mary are not Mary. You know, statues of Jesus, we don't worship statues. You know, that's for sure. They're not identified with the divine, and there's a danger there, you know, that Catholicism flirts with the danger of superstition and the manipulation of these material realities and so forth. But nevertheless, what it says that at certain times, these material objects can become, to use a big word, diaphanous, can become transparent to the holy, transparent to divine reality. I mentioned the medieval mystic Julian of Norwich already, but there's the one wonderful vision that she has when she sees the whole universe in the palm of God's hand and it appears like an almond. You know, that's a sacramental imagination. Or Joseph Mary Plunkett, the Irish Jesuit poet. I see his blood upon the rose, and in the stars, the glory of his eyes. And he goes on and just talks about how all of nature, you know, reflects the reality of Christ. That's the Catholic imagination at work. Or, of course, another Jesuit, Gerard Manley Hopkins. The world is charged with the grandeur of God. You know, again, this is the Catholic imagination working. And so all of this points to the importance of, you know, why do we have liturgy in the Catholic Church? Why do we have incense? And, you know, why do we have processions? And why do we have all this stuff that, you know, some Protestants say, you know, just get to the Word. You know, it's the Bible. It's the Word of God. That's what's important. No, we do all this stuff because it's material, because it's about the world, because incense and holy water and bread and wine and all these things mediate the sacred, mediate the reality of God. Or the concrete historical, my experience, our experience, you know, the anniversary coming up of 9/11, our experience of you know, the freedom of Europe in 1989. All these things are ways that God somehow reveals God's self to us in the midst of history. Or individual persons, we canonize them as saints. We say these people are holy. They are ways, if we imitate them and ask them to pray with us, can be important in the development of our spiritual lives. Again, it's the material that mediates the holy and the divine. Why? You know, it's so interesting. I hang around a lot in missiological circles with evangelicals. And evangelical Christians have struggled for years about, should the church really be involved in issues of social justice? Because they don't have a Catholic imagination. You know, of course, we have to build up this world. We have to honor the holy in this world. We have to work for justice in this world. Because, again, this world is holy. And that a just society can actually mediate the justice and the holiness of God. Latino theologians, Latinoa theologians, as we say, have this wonderful word. They talk about lo cotidiano, the daily. The daily is where we find God. Again, that's the sacramental imagination at work. Or as the Irish religious educator teaches at Boston College, Thomas Groom says, Catholics believe about the more in the midst of the ordinary. You know, this is the sacramental imagination. You know, and this is, you know, it's our seven sacraments are just the outflow of all of this. You know, Catholics live in a world that is filled with sacraments. They're filled with realities that mediate the presence of God. Sacramentality leads to another kind of basic building block of the vision of Catholicism, and that is the very word Catholicity. It helps us explain what this word means. Of course, it comes from the Greek kata and holos, or kata holon, and it means basically that it's according to the whole. It's that Catholicism is open to all truth and to anything of value. So nothing truly good or valuable can be excluded, again, from the raw material of theology or the raw material of Christian life or for spirituality. And every person, every nation, every culture, every race has something to gain from Christianity and has something to give from Christianity. That's why, again, Catholics are on the forefront of movements for enculturation. They're on the forefront for movements of social justice and things like this. They're concerned about culture. They're concerned about race relations. They're concerned about all these issues because there's nothing and there's no one that somehow does not have a place, does not fit. I love to sing that song at Mass. You know, all are welcome in this place. You know, it just somehow, you know, gives me goosebumps because that's the Catholic vision. You know, that's what Catholicism is all about. Now, parenthetically, and I'll say this a little bit later on, we betray this all the time, don't we? You know, but that's the sin. You know, that's the challenge. And that's where we have to reach for fidelity. But we'll talk about that a little bit more. The opposite of Catholicism is not the opposite of Protestant. Rather, sectarian, exclusive, could even say fundamentalist, is the opposite of Protestant because it excludes. The opposite of Catholicism because it excludes. The British lay theologian Rosemary Houghton writes this way about Catholicity. She says that Catholicism is open not only to the highest, but to the lowest. The repulsive. You ever read the novels of Flannery O'Connor? You can understand that, you know. The repulsive, the self-hating. It can never be a cult of the beautiful, which is why it is not for the religious connoisseurs or seekers of fulfillment. You know, sometimes you hear, we have to purge the church of people who really aren't interested in Catholicism. You know, we have to be smaller and leaner and a more pure. You know, that's not what Catholicism is all about. In the famous words attributed to James Joyce, when we say Catholic, we mean here comes everybody. that's what Catholicity is all about. Again, because there's nothing that's not good. You know, things can be perverted, etc. But there's nothing that at base is not good. That's the Catholic vision. And that's why there are and have always been a variety of theologies in Catholicism, right from the beginning. Just ask Barbara Reed or Don Sr. about the variety of theologies right in the New Testament itself. You know, there's not a New Testament theology. There are theologies, and sometimes they're vying with one another, or they seem to contradict one another. And that's the case all the way through the history of the church. It's not this one, you got to believe the same thing all the time, everywhere, that type of thing. Yeah, we have to believe in the Lordship of Jesus. We have to believe, you know, in these essentials. But there are all sorts of ways of explaining that. And from the beginning, there's always been this variety. And that's what Catholicity does. Again, you know, language is able to explain and to reach out and to help us understand the reality of God. There have always been a variety of spiritualities. We're going to have a Redemptorist celebrate the Eucharist. John Schmidt has a very different spirituality. Not that different, but somewhat different anyway from the SVDs or the Franciscans. Chris back there doing the videotape. There are all these different spiritualities. Again, this is part of the Catholicity of the church. It's not a uniformity. In fact, unity can never be achieved by uniformity. It always has to be achieved by the recognition of diversity. You know, so, and that's what Catholicism does. It always protects the particular while protecting at the same time the universal. And so there's, again, that built-in kind of tension that is involved in being Catholic. This leads to a kind of a both-and character of Catholicism. It contrasts with the kind of classic Protestant either-or. You ever read Kierkegaard's either-or? Or what's the guy? There's another... another Scandinavian playwright who has this one of these plays where it's either you believe or that's not Catholicism. It's not this. It's always both and. It's not so much solus alone, but more et and. So it's not sola scriptura, scripture alone. You know, it's scripture and tradition. It's not, you know, it's not just the alone. It's the both and as well. And so again, it's not faith alone, but faith and works. It's not just scripture, but it's scripture and tradition. It's not just, you know, Jesus alone, but Jesus and Mary. It's not just, you know, the sacred over against the secular. It's the sacred and secular together. It's the human and divine working together. It's word and sacrament. It's not authority or freedom, but authority working together with freedom. It's not faith or reason, but faith informed by reason. There's always that balance that Catholicism tries to work out and tries to develop. There are two ideas that are in quite a bit of tension today, as two authors, Timothy Radcliffe on the one hand and our own Bob Schreider on the other, have written about in recent years. Timothy Radcliffe talks about or identifies what he calls kingdom Catholics on the one hand, and these are, you might say, the more, well, if I can use this as a kind of code word, but the St. Giles Family Mass type Catholics, you know, but the more, you know, liberal end of Catholicism that identify very much with Gaudium et Spes, Vatican II's document on the church in the modern world. Very dynamic understanding of the church and how the church should be involved in culture. And then there are what he calls the communio Catholics or the communion Catholics that identify much more with Vatican II's document on the church, Lumen Gentium. Bob Schreider thinks that it's maybe even a little bit more polarized than that. He talks about Gaudium et Spes Catholics, so, you know, the ones involved with or emphasizing the church in the modern world, and then those who would be much more attracted to the later St. Augustine in his work, his great work, The City of God, which was written after the first sack of Rome a couple of years before Augustine died in 430. And Augustine's very pessimistic about the world here. I was amazed if you read the Office of Readings today. Any of you who are ordained, there's a reading from Augustine, and he almost says that human nature is corrupt. I mean, he can be pretty pessimistic, you know, in many ways. But Bob contrasts these two and says that. There's a suspicion of the world in this City of God type of Catholicism, and it wants to emphasize the identity of the church over against the world. You know, so there are these two kind of positions in today's church, and we see them, you know, all the time. We see them here at CTU. I'm sure you see them in your parishes and so forth. And what both Timothy Radcliffe and Bob Schreider say is, but they belong together. And this is why here at CTU, we're so proud to have Cardinal Bernardine's Common Ground Initiative working out of our Bernardine Center, where we try to bring these two groups together, because it's only in bringing the two together that we can really have the true Catholicism. You know, because each needs to dialogue with one another, with each other. Each needs to learn from the other. As I said before, the church in history has not always been faithful to the inclusion that Catholicity actually proposes. Look at the Inquisition, or the cultural sensitivity of missionaries down through the ages, or the cooperation with colonialism, and again, the present polarization that is in the church. But nevertheless, you know, this is something that we are challenged today to somehow to try to bring together. And really, these things are more a betrayal of the vision of Catholicism than they are the actual working out of the vision. Another principle that I want to mention, and I think this is an important one, although it's a little bit philosophical, that's a picture of the great Canadian Jesuit theologian Bernard Lonergan, who is kind of the champion of this particular perspective. But it's this idea of critical realism. It's, you know, I think another basic philosophical principle of Catholicism, along with the analogy of being. And it says, you know, when we know something, we don't know it just because it's out there. So what you see is what you get. So a kind of a raw empiricism. And so there's no fundamentalism in Catholicism. Oh, it says this in the Bible. No, things always have to be interpreted. You know, things always have to be interpreted. But on the other hand, it's not a mere idealism either. You know, that we would say, well, what is real is really, it doesn't really matter. Everybody has their own opinion, and there's no such thing as objectivity. Critical realism tries to balance the two. Again, there's that both and kind of dynamic that is involved in Catholicism. So there's both of these that are really at work. Certainly, we do construct reality. We are products of our culture. We are products of our language, and so forth and so on. But nevertheless, there is objective reality as well. And critical realism, again, tries to say that both of these things come into play. Yes, our doctrines are socially and culturally constructed, but they point to realities. The doctrines themselves are not the reality. but they point to the reality beyond the language, beyond the symbol, beyond the stories, beyond the words. So that's this whole idea of critical realism, which I think is really important in Catholicism as well. And all of this, of course, is based on the fundamental principle, the fundamental theological principle of incarnation. Incarnation. That a particular human being, a male, with a particular kind of hair, a particular blood type, has revealed God fully. The picture here is one that I think archaeologists have developed, saying this is probably what Jesus looked like, given all the archaeological evidence of what people looked like at the time and the style of hair and so forth. Who knows? But the point is, Jesus looked like something, you know, and he didn't look like something else. You know, he wasn't a universal kind of person. You know, he was had a particular height. You know, and he had a particular kind of voice and all that. And it's that particularity that is also the foundation of the Catholic vision. I love this phrase, and those here from the St. Giles Family Mass community know this because I repeat it all the time in my homilies. The phrase from the Latin American liberation theologian Juan Luis Segundo, who says, God is like Jesus. It's not Jesus is like God, as if we knew what God was like and we say, oh yeah, Jesus is that. No, we know God because of this human being. This is really the best way that we can know God. That Jesus clarifies those yearnings that the Spirit has worked up in us. Clarifies the questions. Challenges us in all sorts of ways. But God is like Jesus. And that's the theological principle underlying really the Catholic vision. It points to the importance, again, of the concrete, of the particular, of the historical. My mentor, Tom O'Mara, who's actually here in the audience, I'm honored by his presence, talked in his inaugural lecture as William K. Warren Professor at Notre Dame about Catholicism as an intense form of faith in the Incarnation. When I was a student at Notre Dame, I was Tom's graduate assistant. And I would be particularly in his classes about introduction to theology. And one of the ways that he described Catholicism was as a gypsy wagon. You know, you remember that, Tom? No, I always remember that. But you know, it's kind of loud, it's kind of crowded, it's not very tasteful, you know, but it's kind of, you know, and that's Catholicism. And in his lecture, he has these wonderful lines, which I love to quote. Carthusian abbesses in mitre and stole, mischievous Peruvian acolytes in red cassocks and carrying silver reliquaries with saints' bones and hair, none of which is older than the 9th century. The novels of Graham Greene and the short stories of Flannery O'Connor, these are figures in a procession whose source and goal are the one incarnation in many incarnations. I think that's a beautiful way of saying what I'm getting at. So the incarnation is so central to what it means to be Catholic and to participate in the Catholic vision. So this is the vision, what I've presented so far. A vision built around the principles of the analogy of being, sacramentality, Catholicity, critical realism, and incarnation. And this brings us then to part two, which is a lot shorter than part one. And this is tensions in the vision. As we say, so far, you know, We've talked about this vision of Catholicism, a vision to which the best of Catholicism strives to be faithful. And as it has striven to be faithful, it has developed a rich tradition. And so we see people like Justin and Origen in the second century experimenting, second and third century, experimenting and trying to deal with Greek philosophy and try to develop a Christianity that makes sense in the context of the culture of the time. Whoops, goofed up there. Whoops. I wanted to, I need to get back. Ephraim the deacon in Syria, working out theology through local hymnody and local melodies and local poetry. Hildegard of Bingen, who talks beautifully about Jesus as our mother because Jesus has given us birth as children of God. Or Michelangelo, who did theology as he carved marble and as he painted in frescoes. Or today, Gustavo Gutierrez, who sees the holiness of God in the reality of the poor. Or Mary John Manansan in the Philippines, who does theology out of women's experience as Filipino women. Or Joe de Mesa, who is also here and is one of our visiting scholars this year, who does theology out of ordinary Filipino cultural experience. Or even Bruce Springsteen and Martin Scorsese, who have left the church but can't get away from the sacramental imagery and can't get away from that basic Catholic vision. Real fidelity to this, though, is a very difficult enterprise. And I think all of us in this room know that. The both and vision of Catholicism is not easily maintained. And history, as I've said before, has seen constant compromises, constant betrayals of the Catholic vision. David Tracy and Stephen Happel, in a book that they wrote a number of years ago about Catholicism, talk about how Catholicism, ironically, by taking one side over the other sometimes, has cheated itself out of its own Catholicity, of its own universality. And this is true both on the side of the church's leadership and on the side of the church's faithful. I think on the one hand, there's a danger that people elevate the material. And so devotion to Mary, legitimate devotion to Mary, becomes a Mariolatry. Or, respect for the Pope becomes a kind of a papolatry. Or liturgy becomes superstition. You know, we can manipulate God in some way or another. Or social justice becomes mere humanism. Or working for enculturation becomes a kind of a cultural compromise with the culture. That's certainly true if we emphasize the one side. On the other hand, if we denigrate the material, if we denigrate the whole incarnational aspect, we can become escapist, the fuga mundi, the flight from the world that was so often part of the spirituality of the past. Or we can become asexual or even anti-sexual, anti-female, maybe even anti-male, who knows. Or we can become too pessimistic about the reality of the world. These are some of the dangers in this Catholic vision, because real fidelity is very difficult to maintain. A number of years ago, I read a wonderful book by the British lay theologian Rosemary Houghton. And she has this wonderful parable in the beginning of the book about Catholicism. And she says Catholicism can be described as a story about two twin sisters. On the one hand, there's Mother Church. On the other hand, there's Sophia. Now, Mother Church stands for the institutional, the traditional, you know, the visible in Catholicism. Mother Church is deeply dedicated to her children. She's very concerned about their welfare. And, you know, she is a woman of deep experience. She's seen it all. She's never shocked by anything anymore. You know, she's been around for 2,000 years. And she knows really everything. She's wise. She's full of all sorts of stories and proverbs. You know, there's this rich tradition that she brings. She's a wonderful housekeeper. And her house is full of art, and she has great speakers, and she's playing classical music or, you know, whatever, the best possible kind of music. And everything is always in order. Everything is always right in its place. This is Mother Church. On the other hand, she has a shadow side. She cares so much that sometimes she makes decisions for her children for her own good. She never asks them what they think. Well, I know better, you know, so I don't care about your experience or anything like that. She doesn't always let them experiment. She doesn't always let them think for themselves. And sometimes she can confuse her great wisdom with God's will. She knows the past so well that she's suspicious of anything that's new. Well, we've probably tried that before, and it didn't work, you know, that kind of thing. And she's such a good housekeeper that she doesn't want anything to get out of line. She wants everything to stay in its ordered place. But then there's Sophia, her twin sister, the winsome Sophia. Houghton says she has many other names like romantic love or mysticism or superstition or inspiration or adventure or sometimes imprudence or sanctity. And she also has her bright and her shadow sides as well. She's a free spirit, and she wants everyone to be free. She prefers the new. The risky. Come on, let's try something new. Let's try to, you know, move on, kind of push the envelope a little bit. You know, she says, you know, why are you stuck in the institution? You know, think for yourselves. That kind of idea. She's unpredictable, and sometimes even a little bit irresponsible. I love some of the images that Houghton uses. She says, you know, when she comes to dinner, she brings illustrated books that she's written, and she shows them to Mother Church's children. And they should be doing their homework, but they're looking at these books, you know. And then, you know, after dinner, the children should be doing the dishes, but she's over there playing the piano, and they're all singing together, you know. So there's that free spirit, you know, that is involved in Sophia. Now, there are opposites, you know, there are tensions. But, you know, they need each other. They're twin sisters. And they love each other. Sometimes they say it begrudgingly, but they love each other. It's institution and charism. It's authority and freedom. It's nature and grace. On the one hand, Mother Church is right. We need to acknowledge Scripture, tradition, and the authority. There's a lot of wisdom in all of this. We just can't go off on our own. On the other hand, we need to acknowledge experience and history and newness. So my short conclusion. Being Catholic today is not getting caught up in any ideology, whether it's the ideology of Mother Church or it's the ideology of Sophia. We can't get caught up in an ideology. we have to be faithful to the Catholic vision that has this inbuilt tension to it. It's not ever one-dimensional. It's always something that is both and. And I think this is what we try to do at CTU when we're teaching. Certainly something that I try to do, and I know the colleagues that I talk about are, we try, our motto, you know, is bold and faithful. We have the boldness of Sophia, and we have the faithfulness of Mother Church. And so we want to educate women and men to be Catholics in today's world and in today's church. We want to educate women and men to be always faithful to the bold God, who in reaching out to us has become one with the universe in all its variety, in all its brokenness, and yet in all its beauty. This is, I think, what it means to be Catholic in today's world and today's church. Thanks very much. Thank you. Thank you.